It's May the 15th, 1996. The survivor is Vladka Meed Peltel. René Fireson interview. It's in Los Angeles, California, USA. It will be in English.
It's May 15th, 1996. I'm speaking to Vladka Meed Peltel. My name is René Firestone, R-E-N-E-F-I-R-E-S-T-O-N-E. We are in Los Angeles, California, in the United States, and the language will be English. Good afternoon, Mrs. Meed.
Good afternoon.
Would you please introduce yourself, tell us your full name, your maiden name, spell it for us, and tell us where were you born and when?
I am Vladka Meed. My maiden name is Peltel. I was born in Warsaw, Poland. And I was the oldest in my family, mother, father, and three children.
Would you please spell your names?
And my name is spelled Vladka, V-L-A-D-K-A, capital M-E-E-D.
And your maiden name?
P-E-L-T-E-L is my maiden name.
Did your family always live in Warsaw?
As far as I remember, my family lived for years in Warsaw. I was born in Warsaw, and all my family, my siblings, were born in Warsaw. I even remember the street, Pavia 3.
What is your father's name?
Father's name was Shlomo, and mother's name was Hannah.
What was your father's profession?
Our family, I will describe, was a lower middle class. My father has a haberdash store, and it was small business. The practical person in the family was the mother. Father was a little bit a dreamer, liked very much to read books, and mother was the one who kept the house and helped out the father in this business too. But we were quite comfortable. Our household was always, as far as I recall, full of people from the family. We didn't have telephone at that time in Warsaw, Poland. So family used to drop in, and all kind of problems to reveal to my father, to my mother. So it was a noisy house, but also an outgoing and of interest what is going on in the family and what is going on with people.
How many siblings did you have?
I have a younger sister, 2 years younger, and a younger brother, 4 and a half years younger than me.
What's their names?
Henya was my sister, and Chaim was my brother.
Vladka, do you remember what kind of relationship did you have with your father?
I would say that I resembled a little bit my father, a little bit in character and also in looks. The relation was quite close. We sometimes used to talk about books and about problems in the world as a child even. With mother was, as I said, more practical things. Father was also had an attitude that having three children, and he was very much interested in the so-called social democratic way of life, to send one of the children, and I was the oldest one, to a private school which has also the social democratic attitude in life. So I was sent to a private school, and my sister was sent to a public school. And my little brother, in the beginning, of course, to the so-called cheder, to the religious school. The relation in our house was very close, a very family, close, knitted group of people.
When you say that in character you were very much like your father. What do you mean by that?
It means that I was in character also interested in things which was going on in the world, not only in my household and in other countries, interested in books. I was a passionate reader. And also, I was outgoing. I love people very much. My father also was outgoing. He always was interested in committees in the house or somewhere else. I remember him taking me to demonstrations when it was the 1st of May as a child, and taking me to lectures. And I was interested in it. My younger sister was more interested in the people of the house, with colleagues, with girlfriends. And my younger brother was so young that it is very difficult for me to say his character, really. A nice little boy.
What was the religious background in the family?
My background? As being the oldest in the family, I was also looked up that I have to help out when there were difficulties, when there were problems. And in school also, I was looked up to perform, to be a little bit an example for the younger. I always want to be a little bit above the children of my age. In other words, they had expectation of me to be something a little bit higher than all the siblings. But the relation was very, very close, as I said. And even when I was with the other family people, with an aunt, my mother's sisters, they always, always thought that I will be able to manage or to give advice, being younger. I was quite a good student. I would say always. I was among the first in the class. And later on, before the war, when I start high school, my mother, being the practical one, thought that I should also know a trade. And she sent me additional to art school to learn how to sew, to learn how to cut forms. And I would say that this maybe saved my life, because later when it was formed, when the German came into Poland and the working shops, labor shops were created, I was able to get into one because of my knowing how to sew, how to cut, how to advise. So not knowingly, she foresaw that this can be very useful, and it was useful.
Did you remember your grandparents?
No, I don't remember my grandparents. They died during the First World War.
Both sides?
And I don't remember even one grandparent.
How about your parents? How were they religion-wise?
My father, as I said, I remember that people used to call him Shloime Lechusit, which means that he was once upon years, I don't remember him, very religious. But later he turned around and he had more interest in what was going on in the world, and he became more a social democratic outlook of life he had. So this was the way how he looked at it. And I would say that he was very much involved with what was going on.
How about your mother?
Mother was the mother every time and everywhere, understanding, the practical person who was thinking about the house, thinking how to bring in food into the house, how to manage things. She was the foundation of the house.
So there were no religious customs observed?
there was not a religious house, but I would say a very traditional house. When the high holidays came or other holidays, we, like everybody else of our neighbors, like the whole surrounding where we lived, was quite Jewish, Yiddish-like, traditional. And this was also my house. Not a very religious one, but a very traditional one. A Yiddish home, a Yiddish house.
So your mother lit candles on Friday night?
Yes, Friday night was the Friday Shabbat meal. And at that time, although later on, when I was already a member in the children organizations, and Friday night we used to get together, I was not permitted to miss the Friday night meal. I have to be at home. This is the tradition which was kept. So it was a Shabbat. But at the same time, it was not very religious. My little brother was sent to Haida to know the old kind of religious prayers and so on. But this was like the stop, how far religious it was. But it was a traditional Jewish home.
Did you experience any anti-Semitism as a child?
The house where we live was also occupied mostly by Jews. It was the Jewish section. It was a so-called open Jewish ghetto, the Jewish district. Of course, when we used to get out of the Jewish section, very often we had the anti-Semitic approach. If somebody looked Jewish, or if somebody behaved a little bit different. But I personally didn't experience too much, because as everybody said that I look not typical Jewish. I look more like a Christian girl, which helped me later on also to survive and to do certain work, helping and assist other Jews in danger.
As a child, what did it mean to you that people didn't look at you as a typical Jew?
As a child, it meant more security, to be more able to move around my Polish neighbors. Although we didn't have too close contact with them, but nevertheless, we were part of the Polish society. And to be able to speak fluent Polish, and I did speak fluent Polish, although I went to a Yiddish school, I nevertheless felt more free being able to mingle among the Poles. And this was, I would say, the most important ingredient of looking as a Polish girl, as a child, yes.
When did you begin to comprehend what the differences were?
To comprehend, to understand, and to feel very early. As long as I remember my childhood, I knew right away that I am Jewish and what certain things to expect from hooligans or from Poles which are anti-Semitic or they don't like Jews, or even to beat them up in front of my eyes. So this kind of experiences I had daily. But personally, I didn't encounter any specific things. The same thing, my father also didn't look exactly Jewish. But my little brother, my mother, they did look different. I mean, more Semitic outlooks. And very often he came home crying that the boys beat him up because they called him Jid, Jid, Jid. And we had it every day, this kind of incident.
Are we talking about the time before Hitler came to
power? We are talking the time before the war. Because during the war, when the war started in 1939, things changed. When the war started, the bombardment started over Warsaw. I remember we were in the basement and my father want to quiet us down because we were afraid. We lived on the outskirts at that time of Warsaw, very close to the railroad station, which was constantly an object of bombardment. And he wanted to calm us down, the kids, and he used to start telling a story that he remembers the German, they are not so terrible. Oh, Hitler talked this, Hitler said that. But he remembers them from World War I. And they were quite pleasant and kind. And you will see that when they will come in, this is not so terrible.
Can I go back for a moment? Because we were talking about anti-Semitism before the war. Did you know of anti-Semitism even before Hitler came to power?
Before Hitler occupied Warsaw, of course we know.
No, before Hitler became the Chancellor of Germany.
This was in 1933 he became, yes, Poland is a Catholic land. Anti-Semitism starts in the church. And the Polish people, and especially the simple people, they were constantly, they have the anti-Semitism rooted from the childhood. And it was daily occurrences when they said that, oh, you are a Jew, or that Jit was killed Christ. And it was even, we read in the high schools or in the higher education in the university where Jews were staying, not being singled out, not permitted to be at the same benches that the other students. And there were the pogroms in Pszczytyk as a child, I remember there. Other pogroms, which were also very characteristic in Poland, the Poles in general were the majority anti-Semitic. And so it was impossible even as a child not to feel or to have the atmosphere, to feel the atmosphere about this attitude toward Jews. Before Hitler started his anti-Semitic propaganda in Germany. But even at that time, Poles were the one who picked it up very, very fast. And when my father, for instance, in his haberdash little business, he already was faced that Poles were standing before his business and calling not to go in and not to buy in a Jewish store. So you were facing this kind of thing before Hitler really started the war.
How do you explain the fact that Poland was the stronghold of the Jewish culture?
I explain, first of all, that the roots are in the church. I give I blame the church behavior before the war and certainly during the war. And Poles were quite religious. And this is, I would say, it's rooted anti-Semitism for generations. Even the history, the Poles, they were kings here and there who permitted or give the same all kind of laws easier up for the Jews. But in general, the history of Poland was quite anti-Semitic too.
But Jewish culture flourished in this country, which was anti-Semitic.
Jewish culture, yes, it was the last 100 years when it flourished, and it was a new development of Jewish writers and Jewish literature. This was at that time when the laws were eased up for the Jews. Then it flourished, because in general, the Jews are quite cultural people, and the first opportunity where they could develop a little bit of their own creativity was used up the utmost. It's why it flourished. It was in Poland the largest Jewish population in Europe. It was about 3.5 million Jews in Poland. I would say it was about 11% of the Polish population.
So when did you begin to really feel the change?
As long as Hitler was settling himself in Germany, as strong as the anti-Semitism was being felt and seen in Poland. And suddenly, with the outbreak of the war, we felt it more. I mentioned before how my father was assuring us children that the Germans are not so terrible. And the first few days when they came into Poland, to Warsaw, after the bombardment, after 4 weeks of really heavy fighting, it was no bread at that time, and we have to stay in line. And right the first day when my father went to stay in line for bread, somebody pointed out, knowing him, that he's a Jew, and he was kicked out by a German and beaten up. And this broke him down. He couldn't digest and understand what happened with the German he knew. This was the first encounter right away when they came into Poland.
Do you remember that personally?
Do you remember? Yes, I do remember. I remember because later on I have to take over certain things in our household. A little bit of merchandise which remained from the store, which we had, we have to start selling out to have something to buy some food. And the only person who could do it was I, looking like a Polish girl. They used to give me the stockings and other things and send me out to the other streets where Poles are living, not where Jews. And my mother and sister was going behind me and looking if a Polish patrol or Germans are not stopping me or warning me ahead of time if they are approaching. So, and I was selling the stuff and bringing the money. Later when the order came that we have to put on the armbands, I used to pull down the armbands and go as a Polish girl and sell it. So father was afraid to get out from the house from this first time when he was beaten up. This is why I felt it personally, that I have to be the one who provides for the house some money.
How did it affect the rest of the children? How did it affect the other children, your sister and your brother?
It affected everybody. It affected everybody has to try to help out. They were helping me and later on, before even the ghetto was created, we start looking for places where we can get some work. I remember my sister was working in a public soup kitchen. I was working later on as a cashier in a small cooperative. And my little brother, he was at that time 10 years old, 11 years old. He was already going to replace his father on labor battalions working. So everybody has to do something, otherwise we would starve to death.
Vladka, how old were you when the war started?
About 17 years old.
Were you out of the school already?
I was still not finished with high school. I finished my so-called vocational courses, but I was not, of course, school was right away, was cut off. It was not any more schooling. But at that time, we started to look to get into some labor shops, and be, first of all, to have some work, which is acknowledged by the German, permitted by the German.
Do you remember the invasion when the Nazis invaded Poland?
I remember when they came in. I just mentioned that the first time when they started to line up people for bread, the time when my father was beaten up. Of course I remember.
What happened that day in your household?
The first thing what happened was that we have to look for food. It was after bombardment and we didn't have any food in the house. And this was the first thing, is to look where we can get something. We didn't know to be afraid or not afraid. We were scared, like everybody was scared for the German. But we went out and it was natural that what the Poles are doing, we have to follow just the same way. To go to the places where we can get something, to get the cards. They were orders day after day, and we have also to be involved in it. And little by little, when people, especially Jews, were coming home and beaten up, and when things were being taken away, when orders were that Jews have to give the fur coat, and Jews has to give the jewelry, and Jews has to give up their factories and materials and things. So we start feeling, and the fear was growing from day to day. What is going to be tomorrow? What new order? Jews are not permitted to go on trains. Jews are not permitted to go into parks. Jews are not permitted to have stores. So this, the fear was growing. And this was, I would say, the main atmosphere among Jews, that somehow we are separated. And especially when we start having our armbands, we were even more afraid. We were singled out and right away recognized that we are different.
How did the Polish population change when these anti-Jewish laws became
The Polish population didn't change. The Polish population was taking this, of course, the Jews were different. They are lower than the Poles. I would not say that they sympathize that we are singled out for the in the negative way. It was not a big change for them.
We will have to stop for a minute. We're going to change tapes. After the Germans came in, did your father keep his business?
No, after the Germans came in, my father didn't have any business anymore. No, everything what we had and we were able to save was in the house, and we were able only to sell the merchandise little by little to have for food. And this was the only way how we were able to support ourselves. The business was destroyed.
Your little brother was still too young to go to work.
What did he do? My little brother was too young in the beginning, the first year, to go to work. But later on, he was a substitute in the so-called labor battalion, where somebody who was supposed to go out and work for the Germans, if the person had money, he used to take a substitute. So they were young people going for this kind of work and getting a little bit of money. This is what he did. My sister was working, as I said, in a public kitchen, and I was a cashier in a small co-op.
How long did this last?
This lasted till the ghetto was created. We lived on the outskirts of Warsaw in the suburb Praga. And when the ghetto was created, before the establishment of the ghetto, we have to change and to move out from the so-called Aryan side to the Jewish section. And this was a very difficult time because we couldn't get an exchange of apartment. Usually the Poles who lived in the previous assigned Jewish state, they were looking for better apartment, for larger apartment. And they found it very, very easy. And it was very difficult for us in the beginning. And we were quite concerned. We didn't know what will happen if we don't get. But at the last moment, we got something, a very bad apartment. The water was coming on the walls down. And it was one two-room apartment, really. But we moved in the small apartment at that time. And the ghetto was sealed off in 1940. In October, if I don't make a mistake, the 16th of October. And at that time, really, life changed for the worse.
How were you notified that you have to move into the ghetto?
Oh, they was the law. They were assignments and they were bulletins, the German in the newspaper. So all the Jews knew right away that this and this district, this number of streets is being assigned for the ghetto, and all who live beyond have to move in there.
How much time did they give you to do this change?
There was a few weeks' time that we have to find an exchange, an apartment. And at that time, I remember whatever we were able to take with us on a very small van. And we were schlepping whatever we were able to the small apartment there on Leshno 66, which was assigned for the Jews. This was really the critical point in our life when things started to slide down. Father got sick. He got pneumonia. We couldn't save him. It was no antibiotic in the ghetto. And he died. And mother and sister and brother remained in the with me.
And how old was your father?
47 years. And whatever we were able to sell, still little things, we were selling. We were selling to smugglers, to Polish smugglers, which used to come into the ghetto, bring some food and exchange, buying all kind of stuff what Jews had to sell. And
could you still stay on your job?
My sister was in the ghetto working on her job. She was taken later when the deportation started from her job. My little brother was at home, sometimes going out on the labor battalions, but not too often. And I was also working, as I said, in the ghetto on the job. But at the same time, in the ghetto, I was involved with the illegal youth organization, the social democratic youth organization called Future, Zukunft. And we used to come together, illegal groups, having all kind of lectures, listening to even to music sometimes, having a seminar. But these were small groups reading illegal literature. And this was in a way a little bit of an involvement, which my mother, although she was not too much anxious for us to do this kind of work, knowing that if it will be found out, then dead. It was no school at that time in the ghetto. And we, the young people, started to be involved in teaching the children in the so-called, we called this the children corners, where children who were not able to go to school, the schools were closed, we used to take them together to teach them songs, to teach them how to write, and in a way, giving them a little bit of life. And in the houses there, there were created house committees to help the starvation which started in the ghetto. In the ghetto, in the Warsaw ghetto itself, over 2,000 house committees were created by the Jews themselves, the so-called self-help. an illegal Jewish cultural organization was created. And we, the young people, started to have seminars, I recall, that and later assigned to places to go after the curfew and to have lectures for the people of the houses, which were closed up. So I, a 16, 17-year-old, went to such lecture, and I recall it was on Pavia 30, and I was talking about parrots, about Bonche Schweig at this particular lecture, and two young people, children, were outside, the windows were covered, in case German will come and knock, to have time that we will be able to disperse. And I slept over at that time in one of the apartments of the people. It's very difficult for me to say how the lecture, what they talked, but I still remember the atmosphere, the uplift, that in the ghetto was so much starvation and the typhoid epidemic which started, and hunger and misery. We were talking about literature. And a young girl was talking to older people, and they were listening. And somehow it was the thought, the hope that this will pass. It is a time that will not remain forever. And this kind of hope was constantly in the life of the ghetto.
How did your mother hold up under these pressures?
My mother was really, today as a mother by myself, and I look back, and whenever I mentioned her name, I was wondering how she was able to manage. It was a poor household, really. And nevertheless, somehow she prepared food, a meal for the children. She started selling, we didn't have already merchandise anymore, from the house, the most valuable things to be able to prepare something. She by herself didn't eat so much, and quite often I remind that she wanted very, very much that my little brother should prepare for bar mitzvah, and didn't have any possibility to pay the teacher, the religious teacher, with money. So she was cutting away her portion of bread and hiding it for us children, and this was the payment for the melamed. We knew where she was hiding, in bed, but none of us, although we were very hungry, but none of us really was thinking about taking away this. And I remember my mother, who had puffed up from hunger under the ice and hiding the bread, her portion, to prepare my little brother for the bar mitzvah, which he never had. They were deported. So how my mother managed, difficult to say, how she kept her house clean, without soap, without hot water. But she did. She tried. And my mother was not the only one in the ghetto. These were the mothers trying to keep and to hold on, hoping that it will come to an end, that somehow we will survive.
Did your sister participate in the same youth organizations?
My sister was part, but didn't actively participate. She was more the speaking Polish, having her younger friends, and was not too much involved, I would say. She was also more busy. I was more active. I was more active at that time, always a more active person in the organizational cultural involvement. But when sometimes I used to come home with literature, illegal, and I give it to my mother and I told her, you have to hide it. She didn't ask. She didn't say anything. She put it away somewhere. And then I turned to her a day, two, three. Where is it? I need it now. She gave it to me. So she was indirectly involved in my illegal work. in the ghetto, simple woman, my mother. But one of the mothers, which very little is being talking about it. We talk about uprising, we talk about resistance, we talk about things which is for the eye and for action, but about this simple, quiet, and dedicated souls, we give very little attention. And I think history has to see them a little bit more sharp than as they were.
Why do you think we don't pay more attention to these mothers?
Why I think our time is so different from the time that I lived in the ghetto. Time is now most is taken with action. Let's say resistance is understood if you have a gun, if you stand up with a knife, if you do something. The resistance in different forms, which was expressed in the time of the occupation in the ghetto, was very often a different way of resistance, which has to be understood if you go back to these particular years. It was not the gun and the revolt, but it was the inner strength. It was the tradition, the morality, the ethic, which our mothers lived and our generations before us lived. And it was expressed in simple little things, in thousand instances of resistance, about we take it for granted. We don't mention this, but at that time, it was more than little things. It was strength, which has to be understood.
Where did your resistance lead to?
I would say that later on, when I got involved more in the illegal work, and we start thinking, and when deportation, we heard about deportation in another ghettos, in other towns, and most of the people who were in the youth underground, they organized, not in the hundreds of hundreds, but the very small group. They were, in a way, the foundation of the later organized armed resistance which took place. But when I look back, I think that the armed resistance was possible because it was an ethical, moral resistance going on in the ghetto before deportation. It is a chain. It didn't come suddenly. The young people came from the houses of the parents who were transported to the gas chambers. But the houses were full of beliefs, of hope, of belief in humanity, of justice. And this was a chain leading to active resistance. And this is why I cannot separate the uprising or active resistance or the partisan resistance from the resistance which took place in the quiet so-called times in the ghetto. This was the base, the foundation. And the foundation goes even before the war, the outbreak of the war. So it was a chain of resistance in our Jewish life, which culmination was the armed resistance.
Your armed resistance was from within the ghetto, or did you leave the ghetto at one point?
It started, my armed resistance, I would not say armed resistance. I would say resistance was all the time in the ghetto, before the ghetto. My involvement in preparation for the uprising started from the small little groups. And these were the groups from all kind of political youth movements. The Shomer HaTzair, the Bund, the Communists, the other Habonim. They created later on when deportation was going on, and we, in the beginning, We didn't know that it's really deportation meant death. I remember when some streets were blocked, blockades, we said, and they started to take the Jews out. We thought at that time that the Jews in the beginning are going to other cities, just resettlement to the east. In the Warsaw Ghetto, we saw resettlement from the west. Jews were coming from the German part. Jews were coming from the north. And they were coming to the Warsaw Ghetto. So we understood that now probably deportation will go to other cities. And my mother was very much concerned that if she will be caught and deported, she will be by herself. And she broke a leg in the beginning of the war, which was constantly bothering her. And the father was no more, he was dead. And constantly talking to us, what will happen in another city if I am by myself? And I used to quiet her down that we will never be separated. We will be always together. You will never be by yourself. But destiny wanted different. It was everything which developed was in a different direction.
When did you first realize that people from the West were brought into the ghetto?
When they started coming in, German speaking from Poznan, from other cities, they started coming into the Warsaw Ghetto, and we have to find location. I mean, the ghetto, the council has to find location to, and they were called the refugee points. And then we saw them. So
what,
it's not a question of realization. We came across, we met them every day.
What year did they come?
In 1941, before the deportation started. They started to come from the West.
From the West, meaning from Poland or
from
other countries?
From Poznan, yes, from Poland, from the west side of Poland, yes.
How about from Germany?
Some from Germany, too. Some from Germany, from certain... We realized it, but at that time was not deportation to the east, to gas chambers. Von Schien was the first deported German Jews who came to Poland, not being German citizens, with Polish citizenship. But at that time, we didn't think the war didn't break out at that time, and it was not deportation. So, but this was a realization that deportation can take place, but we didn't think about it. We didn't think in the beginning of deportation that people are really going to be gassed.
What did you think? Where did they take them?
We in the underground heard that, for instance, in Kolo there are vans where people are being gassed. But we didn't realize it. We thought groups of people. Even I didn't realize that it really is that people, whole cities and towns are being wiped out. I thought that it is in camps in the beginning, in resettlements, in other ghettos, in other cities. And this was the main thought of the majority of the people in the Warsaw Ghetto. In the Warsaw Ghetto, people also thought that Warsaw is the capital. And it is open for the whole world, and there are embassies. And how can they do even the same thing in such a big city with so many Jews, a 500,000 Jews in the ghetto, what they are doing in a small town? So people didn't believe that it's really going and being deported to nowhere or being killed.
Who was the underground leadership at the time?
The leadership in the ghetto was the Jewish Council, the Judenrat, but the underground leadership was in the hand of the young people, as I said, of the youth organization. And they formed the so-called fighters organization. And this was in 1942. Deportation started the 22nd of July, 1942, and then representative of youth organizations got together and they something has to be done. And really, I would say in October 1942, the organization came to life, an understanding came that some actions in preparing the youth, if another deportation starts, that a response should be in an organized way. We didn't have any arms. I belong to the first group of the so-called fighters organization. We didn't have any arms at that time. It was a need to get armed. It was a need to prepare ourselves. And in December 1942, they turned to me. It was the Bundes Youth Group, that because I look like a Polish girl, there are a few others on the other side of the wall, on the other side of the ghetto wall, to get out and to walk in the underground on the Polish side, to try to prepare to buy on the black market guns, whatever it's possible, and also to prepare some hiding places for children, if it's possible there, to find out. And this is how I got out of the ghetto. And I recall it was a big meeting in November 1942 from the youth group of the Bund. And they were talking at that time about the organization which was formed, the Jewish Fighters Organization, in the involvement in our responsibility that when the Germans will come to take us out from the shops, to stand up, not to go, whatever it is, to give a resistance. And at that time, each of us got some assignment. I didn't get any assignment, and I felt very low, that the only person, it was a group of 28 or 29 people, young people, and I felt really bad. But when everybody already started to disperse, the leader was at that time of this group, Abraham Bloom, came over to me and told me that your assignment will be different, that you will not remain in the ghetto. Somebody will come and give you some information later on, and you will get out of the ghetto. And the assignment will be on the other side of the ghetto to do the utmost for the fighters organization. And this was my assignment, how I got involved in the fighters organization.
Tell us a little bit about Abraham Bloom.
Abraham Bloom was the leader of the Jewish Bund group. And he was the one also who was responsible, together with the young people there, Marek Edelman, who is now in Warsaw, still alive, Dr. Edelman, and Michal Klepfisch, responsible for organizing the four Bund youth groups in the fighters organization. They were also the representative together and meet with Mordechai Anilevich from Shomer Hatzair. They had four groups. They meet with a representative from other youth groups. And this is how they started to work to coordinate. The first really response of the organized armed resistance took place the 18th of January, 1943. But this was not too much organized yet. And I would not say that it was very successful, but this was the first attempt. And after it, they came to the conclusion that they have to separate the youth groups. They have to live constantly together to be ready in case of need to be in an organized way to step and to stand up. And my assignments were, if I could get, and I got once, a few kilo of dynamite to smuggle this into the ghetto. Usually I had a code number by telephone from the walking shops in the ghetto and from other youth which were staying near the telephone, and we used to give our code and to decide at what point we will smuggle over dynamite or guns or things. And this is how I got more and more involved. I used to come in into the ghetto as a smuggler and bringing in something like butter or something, different things. But the butter was just the paper, and inside was the dynamite, and to smuggle out sometimes jewelry to change it there.
By this time, did you know a little more about deportations? Did you have any idea what is going on the outside?
But this time, the underground knew more about gas chambers, yes. When they asked me, for instance, to get out of the ghetto, at this time, I had to smuggle out a map of Treblinka, which they already knew how and where it is created and formed. And I had the first encounter, very, very difficult, but also lucky. At this particular time when I got the assignment, is for the first time I got to know my future husband. He was working on the Polish side in a Jewish labor battalion. And he was also able, sometimes is somebody has to get out of the ghetto, to bribe the group leader, a Ukrainian. And the underground told me that I have to get in contact with him, where he lives, and he will include me in the labor group, of course, bribing the group leader, the Ukrainian, and to get out this way. And this is how I got to know him the first time. Later on, I met him more often on the Aryan side. At that time, I had the map of the Treblinka in my shoes. And having in my shoes, I stood with all the other people in the group, and I was one woman among men, only men. And they singled me out and they asked me to go to the checking point, what I have. They understood that I have some smuggle or something, some clothing, some special thing. And I went into the shack where the German was checking me. And it was a German there. At the place to go out of the ghetto was Polish police and Jewish police and German. And he asked me to take off the clothes and everything. And I was thinking at that time, if he only would not ask me to take off the shoes, but then he will find that I am done. And this particular moment, the door of the shack got open, and they called him out that somebody ran away. And he went out. And I, on my way, started to put back everything and got back dressed. And when I was dressed, I went out, and I told the Polish police I was checked, and I went back to the group. And the group went out of the ghetto.
We have to stop for a minute again. You were telling us the story how you escaped a Czech smuggling some stuff into the camp, into the ghetto. How was it getting out of the ghetto?
This was how I escaped getting out of the ghetto. I would like to tell you how I escaped smuggling into the ghetto dynamite. This was a different time. It was on the point, the smuggling point of Plac Paresovsky, and over there a group of Polish smugglers smuggled in food into the ghetto. And of course Poles, this was a way of making a living for some smugglers, very dangerous one, because the ghetto wall was always patrolled by German, by Polish police. But in this particular place, it was the Jewish police and the Polish police was bribed. And it was a ladder put at the wall of one side, on the Polish side of the on the ghetto wall. And I was at that time already, I told by phone to my group people, to the youth, where I am going to smuggle in. And these were packages of 5 kilo dynamite put in greasy paper to look like I'm smuggling butter. Usually the smugglers paid a certain amount of money, the foreman, and he was staying near the ladder. And they gave him the money, went up the ladder on the other side and jumped on the other side of the wall into the ghetto. And the smuggle was going on, and it was my next, and I gave also the money to the foreman, and I went up with my package. It was not suspicious for them. And while I was on top of the wall, shooting started. And I was on top, and shooting started to come closer. The foreman snatched away the ladder, and I was not able not to go back to the Polish side, and I didn't see anybody on the Jewish side. And I was afraid to jump, not knowing too much about dynamite, that maybe this could explode. So I was on top, and the shooting came closer, and I was sure that I am done. But suddenly, the two people who were waiting for me saw me there on top, and they made a human ladder from the ghetto side and brought me down, and we ran away just in time. So this was another time of smuggling. At that time, I remember also while I smuggled in dynamite, it was in a factory, Pfeiffer factory, on Okopova Street, which one part of the factory was on the Polish side, where the door was. The other side, where the windows were on the Jewish, in the ghetto. And they told me that this is going to be the best way how to smuggle in. And of course, I came in the guide, which is guarding, was there, and he let me in, but I was having it is vis-a-vis, opposite the factory is the Jewish cemetery. So it was a German guarding the cemetery. But I got into the factory, and he told me, he took me to the window there and told me, okay, give you package. He didn't know what I'm smuggling in, the Polish guard. But the package didn't go through the window. I have to repack this. And I start to repacking together with him, and he was terribly nervous. I was nervous too. And the people on the other side from the ghetto were calling, Festo, Festo, Festo. And finally, I made it in smaller packages, and we pushed it through. And he asked me when I gave him the vodka, the bimber at that time, and some money, he asked me, what did you have there? And I told him, paint. He said, really, paint only? I said, yes, only paint. And I went away. This was one time when I was just scared. So there were all kind of situations where you have to act and to be alert and to have luck. Otherwise, many of my co-workers who also were doing the same kind of work, they fell. They were killed.
The non-Jewish part of the smugglers, were they doing it strictly for money, or were these an underground group?
No, they were doing strictly to make a living for money. These were not underground. Maybe one, I don't know. Because those who did it in the underground were very careful to share what they are doing with anybody else.
Could you trust these people even for the money?
To bribe them? Then I have to reveal what I have. Sometimes you can bribe somebody, but usually you are never sure. Because they can also denounce you. And many, as I said, were denounced and killed because of Poles who did give up.
Your family in the ghetto, did they know what kind of work you are involved in?
At that time, when I was preparing and doing my work on the Polish side, none of my family remained. My mother and sister and brother were deported already. And before deportation, they knew that I am involved. But at that time, I was still in the ghetto. So they didn't know exactly what I was doing, but they knew that I was involved in illegal work.
How come they were deported and you were not?
At that time, when they were deported, it was blocked. I see it before my eyes. It was on Leshno Street, and it was after 4 o'clock, and a Jewish policeman came to his family telling them that they heard in the Jewish police station that this street is going to be blocked and deported. And we waited all day long together with the family. But I was in a separate place. And by 5 o'clock, when everybody gave up, nothing took place, nothing happened, mother and my brother went up to prepare something to eat. And at that moment, when they went up, the street was blocked and deportation started, selection started. And I couldn't see them because the street was full of people. I couldn't see not my brother. I couldn't go up to them anymore. And I, at that time, was having just a piece of paper to show that I'm working in a German workshops, Tebben's workshops. And when I came to the German, he looked at me, I showed him the paper, he looked again at me and sent me to the right. I was young at that time. When I was on the right side, for the people, I didn't know even if this is the right, if it is, but it was the right side. The selection was still going on. I didn't see my brother and I didn't see my mother. My sister was with her workshop there in the kitchen with the staff. So I was looking for them, and suddenly I heard when the van was passing by, calling my name. I want to go to where the voice is coming from, but I was separated. They cut me off. They didn't let me go to move away. And they were taken away. I didn't see them. In my mind, I just heard their voice. Later on, I wanted to go together to go to the so-called Umschlagplatz, deportation place, but I couldn't go through. They didn't let me. And this is how I was separated. And they were deported.
Did you know where?
Yes, I knew. All the Jews from Warsaw were deported to Treblinka, to the gas chambers. Now when I go to Poland once a year, my first walk is to Treblinka. This is the cemetery. My sister was also deported with her group of people from the staff another day.
Here you were by yourself now. You knew that your family is gone.
Yes.
What went through your mind?
And to my mind, at that time when the whole family was gone, was deep, deep depression. I was days crying. The only thing which kept me was the few friends which I had in the shop. And then it was the assignment which I got. And in a way, this was something to hold on. It was not a question to be afraid, it was a question to do something. And I was absolutely done and committed to every little thing which I have to do. And this was everything really which was worth living for.
Did you have fear of death?
Fear? I assumed that I have fear, but I didn't think about fear. Very often after assignment, when I have to do something, I was doing it. When I saw that it's danger, I had fear, but I didn't live with the fear. At night sometimes, when in my mind I went back, I got terrible fear. Oh, it could have been like this or that. But when things were going on, you do what you think you have to.
Did you know your husband by then?
I knew my husband when I was on the Polish side. I met him a few times. We got together. I even went up to the hiding place where his parents were there. And it is what it means, Jewish tradition. While coming to the hiding place, and there were times when the Poles have curfew too during the occupation. And Ben was in my house and couldn't go back in time to their house, sometimes to their hiding place, which was far away. And they knew that he remained with me. So one time I came to the hiding place there on a small cemetery, and the mother took out a ring and she said to me, "I know where Ben is the time he is with you. I would like you to have the ring. This is my ring. It was my engagement ring." And she gave me the ring as an engagement ring. In other words, as an acceptance of the situation. And his father was very religious. The mother was also a religious person. But this was the way of understanding at this particular time.
Do you still have the ring?
Yes, I still have the ring.
Was this a relationship already for you?
Yes, it was already a relationship for me from a girl with a boy. Yes, it was still two young people, a relationship in such circumstances.
Describe the feeling. How is it to have a love relationship for a young person, knowing that any moment either of them can be in deadly danger?
As I said, we knew that every moment is in danger, but nevertheless, there are feelings, and we had the relationship. It was the youth, it was the belief, and probably we believed that we will see the end of it. Otherwise, I cannot explain it in a different way. For me, it was also very important that I knew that I have somebody so close who cares, who, if I will not exist, it is a person who will find out maybe, who will look for me. And this was very, very much for me, to have the feeling that somebody loves you and cares for you and is part of you. And it was natural, this kind of relationship at that time for young people, although danger was surrounding us. This was the life, full of danger.
Describe that situation when you went to visit his parents.
When I went to visit his parents, it was times when I got, the underground has sometimes a small amount of money which came from England, from the Polish government in exile. We had representatives, Arthur Ziegelbaum and Schwarzbart, and sometimes American labor unions and organizations, Jewish Labor Committee, sent through illegal ways money to England, and from there, Polish parachute, like Jan Karski, which is now lives in Washington, D.C., an older gentleman. He was a Polish officer in the Polish underground, which used to parachute to Poland with all kind of money for the Polish underground and bring a small amount also for the Jewish underground. At that time, we had a number of Jews we knew hiding among Poles, and we used to pay the Poles a small amount of money to be able to the Jews to keep them. And such a small amount of money, I was the one very often going to the Polish places where Jews were hiding and bringing. I went also to the place where my husband's parents were, and the people there didn't know that I am Jewish. They knew that I am in the Polish underground. And this was where I used to come. And I recall that Friday, the mother used to have candles, lighted candles. They, religious little traditional things they use in the hiding to go on. My husband has a little sister who lives now in Israel, girl of 10 years. She was with them. It was a very difficult, a small place, and they live all together, living with the scraps, with the very small things which was going out, going on outside, and of course living with the hope that they will survive. Hope was constantly with the people. But I wonder how his mother was not a healthy woman, how they were going on with life in this small hiding place, having hope that they will survive, and they did survive. They did survive. So they survived the war.
So his mother thought that he's dating a non-Jewish girl?
His mother knew that I am Jewish. The parents knew that I am Jewish. But the people where they were hiding, they didn't know that I am Jewish.
Describe that hiding place.
It was on a small cemetery, a Greek Orthodox cemetery. It was one small room, as I recall, where they were living, the Polish people. And a small kitchen, so small. And in this kitchen, they were living, four people. How they were able to sleep, I don't know, probably staying, but they somehow, they slept there. They kept Shabbat. They didn't want to eat meat because it was not kosher. So even there, in their own way, they kept their Jewishness. But they have, it was a cemetery constantly closed. If somebody wants to get in, they were alarmed and they knew right away who is going to come. As I recall, my husband used to help him. If some Orthodox, Greek Orthodox died, he used to walk and prepare the grave for the, as a pole, well, probably. This is how I recall this hiding place.
What is his name? Your husband's name?
My husband's name, yes, I talk about him constantly, not mentioning the name. Benjamin Międzyrzecki, but in the States, he remained Benjamin, but from Międzyrzecki, he became Meed. They said with such a name, it will be very difficult in the States to pronounce a name. So he is Benjamin Meed.
Was Benjamin also involved in the underground?
Yes, Benjamin was involved in the underground. His particular task was to prepare hiding places for Jews, to make double walls and the Jews can hide under, or to make some hiding places where illegal material, pamphlets or papers you can hide. He was involved. He also was involved with finding for children places where to hide. He was involved in his own way, yes.
How was it possible to get the children out of the ghetto?
It was not possible in a normal way. We have to smuggle them out only when we had a place where to put them, to hide. And it was much easier with girls than with little boys, because little boys were circumcised, and little girls can always be as a Polish girl. There were certain points at the wall of the ghetto where we were able to bribe the police, but where smuggle went on. But it was not easy. Sometimes I know a friend of ours. We worked together in the underground, and he was later the so-called engineer and made the primitive Molotov cocktails and organized in the ghetto the primitive factory of ammunition, Michal Klepfisch. They smuggled out their 10-month-old daughter, and they left the child at the steps of a church. And he went away, and he told me, waiting to see what happened with this bundle. And somebody heard crying, and they knocked at the church door, and somebody came out and took the baby in. So he knew that the baby is there.
Also, I read that there were children who were smugglers.
Children were smugglers, but these were children 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 years old, and they were the smugglers bringing in some food into the ghetto. They were small, and through all kinds of holes, to all kinds of places where they were able and they knew. They went out, they bought something, brought in. It was very dangerous. Many smugglers were killed at the ghetto wall.
Was there a name for these kids? Was there a special name that these children were called?
The Little Smugglers. They were poems, smuggler poems, which writers in the ghetto wrote about the children.
Did you ever go back after you came out of the ghetto? Did you ever go back?
Yes. If I say, I said before that I was smuggling in dynamite, I went back into the ghetto, and I went back to the place where it was the center of the illegal youth leadership. And this was also the place where primitive ammunition factory of the fighters organization was organized. And over there I met the leadership. Quite often I was always as a smuggler. Always, every smuggler, it was dangerous to go over the wall. And over there I remember when they showed me how they are preparing the so-called Molotov cocktail bottles, which later on it played quite a role during the uprising in the Warsaw Ghetto. I went back, yes, quite a few times. In this specific place, I met Anilevich, Molotov Anilevich, who was the leader of the uprising in the Warsaw Ghetto, and I met other people.
How often do you think you went back and forth?
It was not a question about going every day or every other day. When the assignment was, it could have been once a week, once in 2 weeks. When it got closer to the uprising, it was more often, because it was the air, the people knew that deportation, that the Warsaw Ghetto was going to be liquidated. We didn't know exactly the date, when, but we knew that it will take place. And at that time, the fighters organization, the groups, there were about 22 groups, were already on alert. And at that time, the communication was a little bit tighter and more often.
When the uprising began,
yeah,
where were you?
The uprising started the 19th of April, 1943. And I was on the Polish side. We didn't know exactly when. And at that time, we heard shooting. And then the few people on the Aryan side want to get into the ghetto. But the ghetto was surrounded more with German patrols. And it was impossible to get, even it was no smuggle, it was nothing. But I tried and I succeeded in getting in very close to the street which has the ghetto wall in the middle of the street. One side was in the ghetto and the other side was the Polish side. There we have one Polish family, Dubiel, who was hiding two Jewish children. And I went up there. I didn't bribe the Ukrainian who was on guard, but I just told him that I have my mother there and I have to see her and you have to let me through as a Polish girl. And finally he let me through. And at that time I was staying overnight there. And I saw how the ghetto was inflamed, how the Jewish houses were burning and people were jumping from balcony. And I remember staying at the window and seeing the flames and the Mrs. Dubiel constantly telling me, get away from the window, they will see you, they will see you. But how could I get away when the world which I was born and connected get up in flame? So this was my closeness to the ghetto at the time of the uprising. Later on, the two people who came into my apartment, this was Kazik Rothheiser and Zalman Friedrich, they got out from the ghetto May 8th, and they came up. They knew my address. They knew in the ghetto where I live. And they somehow came through the sewers, through the ghetto, from the ghetto on the Aryan side, for help. And it was a hectic time how to get help. We couldn't organize it right away. Somehow, after a while, we succeeded to organize somebody who works or knew the sewers for money. And they also organized two trucks which came to a place near the opening of the sewers. And this was the place where 60 ghetto fighters later on got out from the ghetto into the woods. The majority of them got killed in the woods. A few survived.
We'll stop for a minute. We are on tape 4, speaking to Vladka Meed. Vladka, you were on the outside of the ghetto with some Gentile papers. Am I correct?
Yes, of course.
How did you get these papers? Who helped you?
The papers I got through illegal ways. The first paper I got to a friend which worked together with our people, with a small group of underground people on the Polish side. She was Anna Wąchalska, her name. She was a socialist, but she, Michal Klepsich, who was the one who introduced me to her, brought me over to her house. And little by little, she likes me, and she told me, you know, Vladka, what, you need papers to have an original Ken Carter identification paper made officially by the German administration. And I had a little daughter, she told me, who was 2 years old. She died, so I will take the birth certificate out from the small town for my daughter, and you will become my daughter. And so I became her daughter, Anna Wąchalska's daughter. This was my first identification card, the real identification card, which I didn't have for too long, because always somebody was blackmailing, and it was always a danger. If you have too long and somebody else got arrested, you are afraid that the person can give you out. But Anna Wąchalska was really one of the righteous Polish women. And she was like a mother. And once during the uprising, when I was on the Polish side, I need some help. And always when I need help, I turned to Anna Wąchalska. She had contact with Polish people, and she was helping us, the few Jews, underground workers on the Polish side, which belonged to the fighters organization. When Kashuk wrote Isaac and Zalman Friedrich came out from the ghetto looking for help to save a few ghetto fighters, we turned, as usually, to Anna Wochalska for some contacts. And at that time, they were also instrumental contacting some people who have trucks. And the people who had the trucks didn't know for what they are really going, what kind of job and what kind of task they are going to do. But they were hired as smugglers, and they understood this way. They were brought to the place where Kashuk knew that the group is going to wait. And it was very early in the morning. Kashuk wrote Isaac with the two people, and of course under a gun, because they got frightened. They opened the opening from the sewers, and over 60 people of ghetto fighters came out, terrible, disheveled. And on the truck, one was in a German uniform, staying on guard on the truck. The other were hidden under blankets. And they went out from this street to a small place under not far from Warsaw. The other group, which remained and was waiting for the other truck, was not able to get out anymore. Germans came, and it was a shooting. And one of my co-workers was at that time also killed. This was the only really group at that particular time after, it was not after the uprising, but at the end of the uprising, which was able to get out from the Warsaw Ghetto. In the woods, they were not able to be too long. The surrounding Polish population, if they will discover who they are, they will give them out. And it was much more difficult to hide and to find a hiding place in Warsaw, because the German, they had special orders that those who are hiding Jews, they will be killed as well as the Jews. And the whole house will be killed. Nevertheless, two people were smuggled out from the ghetto, and one of them was Abrasha Bloom, one of the leaders. And he didn't have a place where to go, and he was located in my apartment. For the time being, we were looking for places how to help the ghetto, but it was very difficult, almost impossible. And my feeling was at that time that everything really comes to an end. They turned to me that we have to go and to print some special poster from the Polish underground, from the that the Jews are fighting for the freedom, for the ghetto, and from the Poles. And the printing shop, the illegal Polish printing shop, was in Żoliborz. It was also on outskirts of Warsaw. I took this writing to the shop over there, but I have to go through alongside the Polish side of the ghetto wall, and there were people staying there, and the smoke was so dark, and flames from the ghetto, and I heard how people were talking, or take a look, the Jews are frying, or take a look, it's good that they came already to an end, that Warsaw will be liberated from Jews. It was a dangerous piece of walking distance to go, but nevertheless, I made it, and I came back with the posters, which has to be put up at night on the houses. When I brought back the posters, two evenings later, in my house with Abrasha Bloom, a Gestapo person and a civilian came up, and they closed the apartment. they took out everything and they found the Jews in Russia. I didn't admit that I am Jewish. They took whatever it was valuable, they took. And they told me that to remain there, you are being closed and the Gestapo will come in a few minutes to take you out. Abrasha and I remained in the apartment, in my apartment, and we heard how the lock on the other side is closing. We didn't know what to do. We waited half an hour, nobody showed up. And finally, we start talking, and I said to Abrasha, what do we do with the remaining posters which we have? We have to disregard them. We have somehow not, if anybody comes up, they should not find that we belong to a legal organization. Then it will be even worse than being just the Jews because they will torture us. I started to disregard the papers, to burn, to flash. And when we did it, we were waiting. Nobody came up. And then Abrasha Bloom told me, you know, we have to get out of here. But this is on the fourth floor. How could we get out from the fourth floor? So we took the sheets and we put them together and we fastened it to the radiator. And then it was who will go first. And I said to Abrasha, listen, you have a wife, you have two children in hiding. You have to see, maybe you can get through it. Maybe you can get down. In the beginning, he was not so anxious, but he said it's really, it makes sense. So he went and he put himself around, roped around with the sheet and lowered himself down. But while lowering himself down, he said, you know what, I will bind you a little bit that you couldn't do anything if something happened that you couldn't do and prevent this. And while he bound me and he lowered himself, suddenly I heard a very big noise. He fell down. I don't know from how high he fell down, but he fell down and he woke up the whole building. And police came up together with him. And they took us both to the, he was able to walk. They took us both to the police station, provided that in the morning the Gestapo was not there, but the Polish police. We went to the police station, and over there, I was thinking, what do I do now? How can I notify our people not to come to my apartment? Because it will be a danger not only for us, but also for the other. It was in the middle of the night, and I didn't come up with any idea. I was put in a cell where the prostitutes were, and he was taken to the men's side. In the morning, around 7 or 7:30, one of the policemen was changing the guard, and he is going home. And I found in my pocket, I found a few zlotys, and I said to him, maybe you can notify my mother. And my mother was Anna Wochalska. Just notify my mother that I am here and it's a misunderstanding that they found a Jew in my, I didn't say that I am Jewish, in my apartment, and please do it. I was not sure that he is going to do it, but it turned out he did. Maybe he thought that I belonged to the underground. Maybe it was one of the Polish policemen who had a little bit of heart. After all, I was a young girl at that time. And they took away Abrasha Bloom to the Gestapo, telling me that I am going next from the Polish police station. And I was sure that this is the end. How I felt at that time, I didn't feel anything. All kind of thoughts went through. I was not afraid. I knew it is the end. a half an hour later, after, or an hour later, after Abrasha was taken away, the door opened, and one of Anna von Halska's nephew came in, and he told me, "Don't be afraid, we bribed the captain from the police station." What turned out that the policeman gave my note to Anna von Halska. She knew one of our illegal meeting points. She went there and she started screaming, "They have to do everything to take me out. And for 10,000 zlotys, it can be done," because she is still in the police, in the Polish police prison. And they somehow they get together the amount of money very fast, and they bribe the captain. And this nephew took me out from the Polish police station. And this is how I survived. And Abrasha Blum was taken. This was one time when really I don't know how to thank Anna Wochalska, because she really rescued my life. This was a remarkable, righteous person, remarkable. On the Polish side, during the uprising, we felt, the few Jewish underground worker, that really things come to an end. The ghetto, the hiding places, well, that maybe we will be not able even to survive. We are the last. Nevertheless, after the uprising, a short while later, again the underground summoned me that to start looking for hiding places and to start to contact other camps and to do the utmost to give them, to send them some illegal papers, some illegal identification cards, to rescue as many as we are able. So my task was not Warsaw anymore so much, to contact other camps. And I was the one who assumed new identification card. And I went to Radom camp, I went to Kielce camp, I went to a partisan group not far from Kielce, from the Częstochowa partisan group. When I came to them, it was a group from Shoma Hatzair. They were hidden in a small shack full of hay, full of dirt. They didn't believe when I came that I am from another political group. Who sent it? And I told them that Antek Zuckerman sent me, the one who came out 6 days before the uprising on the Polish side to prepare more ammunition, but he was able to do. But he had contact that in certain places of young people from Shoma Hatzair are hiding. They also belong to the fighters organization in the other city, and they don't have any contact, and we have to help them. And when I came, they told me that it was the last time that they have money, and if I would not have come and brought them some money, they will not be able to remain in the hiding place. So I was there, I slept over with them, and it was to me like part of myself, young people. I never saw them in my life, but Jews, people who survived. And then they also, the only request they have, don't forget us, remember. They gave me some pictures to prepare them for identification cards in case they will have to go out. And I went a few times there, and one time when I came to the same place, nobody was there. It turned out it was after a long while, we didn't have any money, it was impossible to go on train, and I very often went on train as a smuggler without any special identification or permission. But nevertheless, I went. It was like a commitment, an inner commitment to go. And when I came, nobody was there. And I asked the peasant, "Where are they? What happened?" she was not able to feed them, and they have to leave because the whole village start talking that she's hiding Jews. And they went to the woods, to the forest. But she said, if you will go in this direction to the forest, the nearest house is the person who is guarding there. Ask them if they saw a group. And I went there. It was everything to go on foot. It was not going by train, not going by car. And when I came there, the old man told me, yes, there are some Jews who are coming at night, and maybe if you will sleep over, you will be able to meet them. I slept over, and it's luck again. At the same night, they was knocking at the door, at the window, not at the door, and they recognized me, and it turned out that of the 11 who were hiding, 6 perished already, and they were killed by Polish partisans, not by Jews, not by Germans, not by just smugglers or blackmailers, but by partisans who were fighting the same German, the same enemy. They killed the Jews. Why? Because they were anti-Semitic. Because they couldn't understand that other partisans have also right to survive. Not they couldn't understand, they couldn't feel. And the only way how to protect them was to ask a letter from the leadership of the Polish partisan, of the higher echelon, that maybe this will help. Later on in Israel, 2 of the people from this group I met, they survived. With the money, they came back to the old hiding place, and the 5 survived, and 2 I met later in Israel. So my task after the uprising was to contact camps, to contact people in hiding, and what was only able to help them to survive.
Vladka, during the uprising, did you have contact with the ghetto?
Nobody has contact during the uprising with the ghetto. You read sometimes in the Polish papers or books about contacts. We on the Polish side, the leadership, the few who were in contact, one of our leaders was Mikołaj Feiner. He is dead already. And he was in contact with the Polish underground. We didn't have any direct contact, although some claim that in this part, some group of Armia Ludowa, of the liberal, of the leftist, was helping them. We didn't know at that time about this at all. When they were alone. The ghetto was absolutely alone, forsaken. And even today, when I think and I look back, history is being made by Poles or by others. Our Jewish people were absolutely isolated and by themselves. And I think that we have to remember this, because history sometimes is being made by political groups, and what is good for them and what their image they would like to be seen in history, they write it down. But the reality was different. We were forsaken. And I think that in the future and even today, history has to inscribe the truthful fact how it was really. We were even forsaken by the allies, by the outside world, by the so-called free world. We turned to them. You know, later on, I was in the Polish uprising, and together with the Polish people, as a Polish girl, I was witnessing how the planes came from England, from London, from other places, and they were dropping ammunition, they were dropping medication. But when the Warsaw Ghetto uprising took place, our skies were empty. We didn't have any help for anybody. The ghetto went up in flame. And even the free world didn't do anything. I remember we read about Arthur Ziegelbaum later on, that in London he committed suicide. May 8, his wife and his child perished in the Warsaw Ghetto. And I was connected with this case. I want to mention it. I found a place for the little boy. He was 8 years old, Arthur Ziegelbaum's boy. And the mother, and I described the place to the mother, and I told her that it's a place only for the child. It's not for you, maybe later on. But right now, you have to decide. And Abrasha Bloom, who was the one who was talking to her too, said, you know, make the decision, give away the child. We know that something is going to happen. But her decision was not to separate. She went through all the deportations, and he will perish if she is not there. And she decided no. And they both perished. And Arthur Ziegelbaum committed suicide, not because only of her. He could not arouse the interest and the help of the outside world, of the free outside world, for the help of the Jews. And this is also history, should you remember.
You talked earlier about mother's resistance and how they had to make different decisions, and sometimes the wrong decisions.
Of course, it was very difficult decisions to give away a child, but at the same time, it was the only decision. The two girls, the Dunkels, which I, one is Dunkel, she married, she's in the States, which I helped to survive. The mother gave away the child, both girls, they were twins. And she said that she will perish, but at least maybe it's a chance for the two girls. And of course, there were difficulties to hide them, to change places. Somehow they survived. It's difficult to say that she did right or wrong in these circumstances, of course. But I just tell you how situations are. I don't blame the mother who didn't part. And I don't encourage mother who did. I don't know how I would act. I don't know. But this is the situation, how it was. You didn't know what to anticipate at that time.
When the Gentile Warsaw Uprising started, where were you?
I was in Warsaw when the Polish Uprising broke out. It was in August 1944. I was together with the Polish people. And in the first 2 days, 3 days, we saw the German army getting back, going back from the east to the west, and we thought that it is just the right time, a day, two, three, and we will be liberated by the Russians. But the Russians stopped at the Vistula, at the river, and didn't go further. And in the meantime, the German occupied, didn't lose the occupation of Warsaw, but they remained in Warsaw. And the uprising was a very bloody uprising.
Did you take part in that uprising?
I tell you, I was part of the uprising together with the Polish population, preparing things and doing what the responsible people asked to do. But particularly in the Polish, as a Jew, I didn't have the contact of the AK. But I was part of the Polish population, as a Jew, but as a Pole. And at that time, we had a very difficult problem with Jews who were hiding in Polish apartments, because they have to get out of it, and many didn't have where to go. And many were caught, and many were killed. So it was a very difficult situation. It constantly, the German were bombarding, and they were in different places. So even those who during all the years were in hiding, some of them were killed. killed by the German and sometimes killed by the Polish anti-Semite AK.
How long did the uprising go on?
The Polish uprising took by 2 months. And then all Warsaw was evacuated. And at that time, I and Ben were together. And his parents were in a hiding place with Poles, and they were in another place. They were also evacuated. They survived, but as Poles. And we were also out of Warsaw, and we survived in a small village in Grujec as Poles. And his father survived as a person who cannot hear and cannot talk. So his Polish was very bad and had a Jewish accent. He looks good, but till he opened his mouth. And if he opened his mouth right away, you knew he's Jewish. So this is the way how he survived. And the mother was together with his sister, as Polish people in a small little village, they survived.
The evacuation of Warsaw was organized by whom?
This was organized by the Polish underground, the Armia Krajowa, the Polish military underground. And also it was participation of the Armia Ludowa. This is a smaller Polish group, the more leftist group.
What happened after the uprising?
After the uprising, after 2 months, the German evacuated all Warsaw, and it took till from September till January 17, the new attack of the Russian liberated Warsaw. So the Russian came in January to Warsaw, and this is when I came back to Warsaw.
Let's wait for a moment. When you came back to Warsaw after the Warsaw uprising, where did you go?
We were in the small town in Grujec with Ben. And when the the Russian offensive started in January, and we saw the Russian coming, we decided to go back to Warsaw, knowing that Warsaw is destroyed. But nevertheless, we thought that certain people are alive, and we knew the bunker where a few of our Warsaw ghetto fighters were hiding. And we went to Warsaw by foot. We were walking from Grujec to Warsaw. We came, of course, it was destruction, it was army and civilian and certain houses were destroyed and bombed. It was a very sad and very bad situation. But we went and we met a few of people who were hiding. We kept together in Warsaw when the Russian came. And little by little, we get to know more. I was sure that we are the only one, the only two or three or four. But people started to come in from hiding places from the surrounding to Warsaw. And as the front went more and more to the west, more people, Jews, came into the city. But Warsaw was destroyed, and it was very difficult to find a place where to live. So when Lodz, the city which was not destroyed, was liberated, many people went to Lodz. And Ben and I also decided to go to Lodz. In Lodz, a Jewish community started out, and a Jewish committee was organized. And the first people who saw me there turned to me to be the so-called director or manager of the Jewish Cultural Department. So I became the director of the Jewish Cultural Department. And how the Jewish committee looked at that time was a peculiar, really picture. People were coming from concentration camps, from the forest and putting on the walls, on the doors, scraps of paper. Did you see? Did you hear this and this name? Maybe you heard something. Please notify. And although everybody knew that you will not have anybody, nevertheless, the walls were covered with paper. And I was working in the committee and observing this. And suddenly you can hear, oh, whom I see here? Or how did you survive? And being part of the tense and nervous atmosphere, knowing that I don't have to look for anybody because the people from Warsaw were sent to Treblinka and none of my closest one survived. Nevertheless, I also put a scrap of paper on the wall. Maybe my sister, my brother, they were so young, maybe somewhere they are. But I was not lucky in this situation. None of my family survived, absolutely nobody. But I was walking there, and the first I remember that I organized at that time the first Jewish event of people, of survivors for survivors. I did it with all my soul, what I still had in me, in Jewish songs. And it is very characteristic that in the camps, many Jewish songs were created. In the Vilna ghetto, many songs were created. And at this event, they were singing, those who had voices. And the reaction, the response of the people who came was overwhelming, overwhelming.
What songs are they?
What?
What songs are they?
Oh, they were Jewish songs from the ghetto. In the Vilna ghetto, for instance, I cannot sing here. Maybe someday, but not now. In the Vilna ghetto, they had theater during deportation time. In the Warsaw ghetto were Polish songs, but people were singing. And also they were singing Israeli songs, because at that time it was the trend and the feeling to go to Israel, to go to your own country, which is not your own yet. It was an atmosphere of survival and at the same time of sadness, realization that you are, after all, you survive, but you are alone. And this was very difficult to live with. You went on, you were constantly waiting, maybe, hoping, and realizing day by day, time passed, that no, this is the reality. And at the same time thinking that life goes on. And then in Poland, it was again anti-Semitic incidents, people coming from the forest, from two small towns, were robbed, were killed. The Poles, Ukrainians, and others, they didn't want them back. And I remember also before I left Poland and before I worked in the Jewish committee that the pogrom in Kielce took place, a pogrom, a Polish city, where it was a Jewish community from a small group of survivors, and it was pogromed by, it was by Poles, and the Polish police, and even at that time, the Russian police did not take care, did not control the situation, and over 40 people were killed at that time, saying that the Jews are taking, or some rumor, the Jews were taking blood from a Polish boy to prepare the matzos for Pesach, for the holiday, for Easter holiday, which was a rumor later that they killed the boy was alive, they found the boy, but nevertheless, after the boy said the truth, for the people already were killed.
Was there a Polish government at the time that was acting?
Yes, it was a Polish government, but it was under the Soviet, not occupation, but supervision.
And nothing was done about these pogroms?
later on, after the people were killed, they controlled the situation. Now, not long ago, they told me that in July, it's going to be a monument put up for the over 40 killed Jews. But it was a pogrom, and this was after the German. They were not any more German. Pogrom by the Poles.
I would like to take you back.
So it was anti-Semitism in the towns, on trains, in people were afraid to go back to the places in smaller towns. But even city like Kielce, it was a pogrom.
I would like to go back for a minute to the time when you came back to Warsaw the first time.
Yes.
And you saw the ghetto. What did you feel?
At that time, I didn't see the ghetto anymore. I just saw rubble. And my first instinct when I came back was to go to the cemetery and to put up a tomb for my father, because I knew that he died with a natural death and he was burned at the cemetery, but I couldn't find his grave. There were skulls on the ground, and I didn't know which is his. Which is his grave? How can I put up a tomb? And I prepared already the stone. Nothing. I couldn't find the grave. Years later, I put up a symbolic tomb for my father. But it's just a symbolic tomb. It's not a place where he really was put.
Were the graves dug up?
The graves were broken. They were Polish grave diggers which took out the skulls, and they took out the teeth and the gold teeth. And this is the way how they were handling the... It is so difficult to think about that, you know, even how people can do this to the dead.
Did this happen before or after the uprising?
This happened after the German left. Because the German would not tolerate that somebody will do these things. They would be afraid. But after the German left.
So what did you and Ben do after that?
So after we decided to leave Poland, although I was working in the Jewish committee and his parents were united with him. And we decided to leave Poland. We went to Germany in the meantime. We contacted people in the States, and they sent out visas for us. And we came to the United States on the displaced person visas, which the President Truman assigned. And when we came here, we didn't have family, but we have friends from before the war. And I started that time talking reminiscences. And they turned to me, the Jewish Daily Forward, that I should write articles. And I started to write articles. Every week an article. I wrote about 27 articles. And from the Forward, they turned again, if you wrote so many articles and the writing is fine, write a book. And the articles were the base. I started the book when deportation started. I didn't go back from before the war because this was really the knack. The deportation was the main difference which cut off life. And my book on both sides of the ghetto wall, which I wrote by myself in Yiddish. It was later translated into Hebrew, and then into Spanish, and then into English, and then, not long ago, to Japanese. So of all the languages, and it is a little bit, for me, a surprise that now more and more is being taught about the Holocaust than in the beginning when I wrote the book. I remember when I wrote the book and they wanted to publish this in English, the English publisher said it's no interest for Holocaust literature at that time. And this was 10 years after the Holocaust. today, 50 years after, is more awareness what took place than it was right after the Holocaust. And my interest now, when I started reading what people are writing or talking about the Holocaust, and especially about armed resistance and about that people went like sheep to the slaughter, was such a resentment that I dedicated a lot of talking how the real situation in the ghetto, how the thousand instances of resistance Jews put up, about what so little is known and not even recognized in today's time when violence is constantly on the daily agenda. And Ben also, Ben my husband, Benjamin, that he also dedicated in organizing commemorations. He organized each year a large public commemoration. Once 2 years ago, President Clinton came, Vice President Gorin came. Thousands of people are always present. He's also the one who is organizing the commemoration lately in the Rotunda. And he is one of the first builder of the Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington. Our life is very much connected with the Holocaust. It's an inner dedication to a life which is normal and which very often I think it's not recognized. Lately, you know, I think that we are talking so much about the number of 6 million, about the people who were killing the perpetrators. And we see the numbers, we see statistics, but we don't see the life. Very little about the life in the ghetto, the life before the outbreak of the war, the life after, the continuation of life, and what life the survivors built later on. 2 children were born in the United States. Both are part of our life. We spoke with the children in Yiddish till they started school, not because we were not able to speak English. We want to preserve something from the past in a direct way. We sent them to a Yiddish school, and it did not disturb them to become physicians, doctors, both of them. They speak, they write Yiddish, my daughter sings Yiddish even songs, and my son taught Jewish history while going to medical school. They both are physicians, and I have a feeling it's a continuation. And this kind of continuation, I constantly would like to have it seen among Jews, and I would like not the Jewish population, the American or not American, the other religious, to know what kind of life was destroyed. Not only people, but what kind of values were destroyed, what have become of those people who have lived. And this is important. This is why I organized a teachers seminar of public school teachers from high schools who are implementing the history of the Holocaust and Jewish resistance, as I understand, which the culmination was organized armed resistance, but it's a chain of resistance. And the seminar which I organized, the 3 week in Israel, and now with a stop in Poland after the fall of Jaruzelski's government, is in a way satisfaction how the people see the Holocaust with the eyes of a survivor who was part of the life which is no more.
Does the preservation of this Jewishness have anything to do with religion?
Of course it has to do. Jewish history is constantly connected and part of religion. Of course, it has to do with religion, it has to do with tradition, it has to do with moral, with ethic, it has to do with a philosophy of life, which has to be understood by non-Jews too.
You didn't tell us, when did you get married? When did you and Ben get married?
Oh, I didn't tell you. It was a really a historical time. It was right after the war. Right after, it was still, the Russians were still in Warsaw. And the parents, when we came back to, I have to go back, when we came back to Warsaw, the parents came from their hiding, and his uncle also was there, he came from hiding, and they start talking to me, you are together, you have to have a Jewish marriage. And it was the first, I think, Jewish marriage, not in Warsaw, but in the suburb of Praga. And at that time, I have to get something white. And I didn't have anything, it's nothing to get. So I bought on the market a white blouse. And this was my white dress. And they were 10 Jews. It was very primitive, very modest. But it was an official Jewish wedding, yes.
Was there a chuppah?
Yes, of course, it was a chuppah.
And a rabbi?
It was somebody who gave chuppah kiddushin. It was not a formal rabbi, but somebody who had the right to give us chuppah kiddushin, yes.
Did you have a dinner after that?
Yes, my mother-in-law, Ben's mother, she prepared a very nice soup. It was not the festive dinners we do in America, in the States, the wedding. But it was a festive occasion, yes. It was a festive, formal, so-called occasion. And it was a real wedding.
When when you came to the United States, did Ben's parents also come?
No. We came to the United States, we got the visas. But before our leaving Germany, Bremen, Ben's parents went to Israel before. They were able to go before, and we were waiting to go. And in the meantime, the visas came from the displaced person, visas, and we came to the States. So the parents were in Israel, and we were in the States. But we were in constant communication. We went there in 1949, a year after the establishment of the Israel. We went there at that time, we have already 1-year-old daughter. And it was really a joy when they were playing with them. It is, you know, when I come to Israel, it is like a continuation of Jewish revival. And it's something always very close to me. Although I was never a Zionist, political, but I got very close to the Jewish people after the Holocaust, very close. It's part of me. And wherever a Jew lives, it can live somewhere in Japan or something, I feel it's part of me.
You have how many children now?
We have my daughter, she is a doctor, medicine. She has 2 children and lives in Phoenix, Arizona. And our son, he's internal medicine, rheumatology, he lives in New York, and he has 3 children. So we have 5 grandchildren.
Tell us their names.
Jessica is my oldest grandchild, our oldest grandchild. She is 17 years old and just told me that she made Dartmouth Ivy League College, and she's going to attend. Havale is 13 years old. And the little one is Jonathan, Laser Jonathan. He's 5 years old. And my daughter's children is Janine, 16 years old, and Michael, 14 years old. So together, 5 children, grandchildren. I'm very proud of them. They very much know my past. And I was, I took pride when I went into the room of my granddaughter, the oldest one, and above her bed was my false identification card, which is in the Washington Museum placed. She put in a frame over her bed. This is my son's granddaughter. And my I have to leave my grandson, Michael. When it was the question about to mention in history class about what of the women you remember and you would like to talk about, which showed some specific heroism. And this boy said, my grandmother. So the teacher asked him, how can you show us that she wrote a book? So, okay, then you have to tell us about the book. You have to read the book and give us a report. He called me up from Phoenix and said, Bubi, I have to make a report about the book. Can you tell me what? I said, no, you have to read it. He read 100 pages and called me again. I read already 100. Can you give me the end? I said, no, you have to finish it up. So he had to finish the book, and he finished the book, and he told me that he got an A+ because he had a report, and he said everything what the teacher expected. And this is how he learned about my past. I never talk with them too much about it. It is in a natural way they know.
Did you ever get in touch with Anna?
What Anna?
Anna, who gave you the papers, who was your mother in Poland.
With Anna Wochalska? Oh, I have history with Anna Wochalska. Anna Wochalska remembered always the birthday of my son and my daughter. And she used to send me all kinds of books or sausages. And one time I got a package from her with a sausage so small, it took about 2 months till it came to us. And in the meantime, it dried up from a big sausage, it became a very small one. And she sent to my son, Król Maciusz I from Kolchak, Janusz Kolchak. This is a Polish writer who wrote specially for children. And I read it to my son in English, of course, translating. And he knows, he still has it, he put it away. So Anna knew about our children, and she was sending gifts, and I was sending to her gifts, medication. We were in contact till she died. And I am still in contact with her sister, with Marisha Sawicka. She lives in Lodz, and whenever I'm in Poland, I'm in contact. And of course, I help her, I send some money. So I am in contact with them, of course, very
much.
Did
Anna have any children?
No, this was the only daughter whose identification card, the birth certificate I had, she gave me. She had one daughter who died now.
Did you know Kolchak?
Just from reading, and just one time while it was doing deportation, I was in the house of one of our hiding places, and I saw through the window how at that time all the orphanages were deported, not all, but four. And among them was Janusz Kolchak, and I saw him marching with his orphanage. And this was August the 5th, I think. And at that time I saw him from the fourth floor looking down. He was going through Zamenhofa, and all the stooped men and the children looking bewildered around, not knowing exactly where they are going. Maybe he knew where he's going, because later on I read that he was suggested and he was being asked to get out on the Polish side and to hiding the people. He was a doctor, but he was also a very famous educator in Poland, and he was a writer. But he didn't want to leave the children, and he went with them to the trains.
What message do you want to leave to your grandchildren?
There are a few messages I want to leave. The first message is, I would like very much the people should know and understand this chapter, this unique chapter of history, the Holocaust. They should understand the Jewish resistance. I would like also to say to people not to take for granted not freedom, not justice. You have to stand up for it. You have to defend this. To be your brother's keeper, to remember that the other need to your help. Not to be passive when things are going on around you. Not to be indifferent. To be a participant in life and to defend the rights of humanity.
What about your little children, the grandchildren? Anything specific to them?
The message is to them just the same as the message then to others. They are part of the human society.
Vladka, I want to thank you for this interview. I am very honored that you told us your story.
Thank you too for being able to say something about the past, which is part of me, and I hope that it will remain part of other people's, of human beings.
Thank you very much.